Do you like Windows updates so much that you want to get them early? Well, probably not when I put it like that, but what about getting all the new biggest Windows features before anybody else, and also having your feedback on those features having more impact than normal on the final release? I'm talking, of course, about the Windows Insider program, which is basically just opting in to get beta and other early Windows builds. You may have heard of this because this was how you could have tested Windows 11 early, but even if you do already know about the Insider program or even are a part of it, stick around because I'm also going to demystify some stuff that you probably have wondered about. I'm going to go over the different so-called Windows Insider channels, as well as when you should and should not consider opting in to these early builds. Also, I'm going to talk about another secret way that you can get some other early builds that most people don't know about, and I'll put all the timestamps in the description. So real quick, I'll go over the basics of the Insider program. It's pretty self-explanatory, so it shouldn't take very long. There's actually several different Insider programs for different Microsoft products, the Windows Insider program, of course, being for Windows operating system, where you get early Windows builds, which are basically just incremental upgrades that work towards an eventual public release. But there's also Insider programs for Microsoft Office, Xbox, Visual Studio Code, and some others, but I'm just going to focus on Windows for this one. In the Windows Insider program, there's different channels that determine how early you get certain features that are not in the public release yet. So these are going to be the dev release channel, which is the earliest, then there's the beta, and then there's the release preview channel. These channels used to be called rings, where the dev channel used to be called the fast ring, and the beta was the slow ring. And the different channels are going to be updated with different frequencies, generally with the dev channel being the most frequent, and then the release channel the least frequent. Now, before I go over the details of the different channels, you guys know that I think security and privacy are important. So if you're watching this video, there's a good chance you have used a computer before, and therefore have signed up for lots of online services over the years. And with that janky segue, let me introduce you to today's video sponsor, Mine, which, joking aside, is legitimately really cool. Mine is a free service that lets you find out which companies have your data and lets you control where you do or don't want to keep it. You can start out by going to saymine.com and just sign in with your email account you want to analyze and give it a minute to do its thing. Here, Mine will only analyze the subject line and the sender of the email plus some basic metadata like the date to figure out which companies you've interacted with, but as their privacy policy states, they don't collect any of the content of your email for this analysis. Then when it's done, it'll show you the results. And turns out for me, at least 240 companies have data on me. Dang, son. On the My Footprint page, I can see a selection of these companies, but since I was feeling brave, I looked through the entire list here, which is eye-opening. By clicking See More for a company, it shows me, for example, that EA stores info like my financial and identity data, as well as online behavior, in addition to having a somewhat elevated exposure risk. Now, here's another company next door that I barely even remember using, and I don't really want them having my data. So what I can do is click Reclaim, and it will compose an email that will be sent directly from my inbox to the company. And this is important because companies generally only honor data deletion requests that come directly from the person. So after you give Mine permission to send the email, you can track and review your requests and even cancel it within an hour if you decide to change your mind. Now, Mine is free for the moment, but is planning to move to a subscription model for additional levels of service soon. So be sure to visit saymine.com now and sign up. And I'll also put the link in the description. And so with all that being said, let's continue. So let's get into the dev channel. So this one has the earliest builds. It's kind of like a work in progress for the most part, so it's not exactly stable, and it could have some stuff in there that could break things. So I would definitely not recommend installing this on any kind of computer that you'd use for mission critical work or anything that you really rely on. Definitely not some kind of work computer. And this is especially so because you generally can't usually leave the dev channel and go back to getting regular Windows updates without doing a full clean install of Windows. I'll talk about that later. But so I would definitely recommend just doing the dev channel on like an extra computer where you just really want to experiment with stuff. One thing that's unique about the dev channel is that new builds are not necessarily tied to any final public release build. So features just kind of get added randomly, I guess you could say, and might show up without warning and might even disappear without warning or never end up in a public release. And also when a feature gets added to the dev channel doesn't necessarily mean what order that it's going to end up in public. So you might have one feature that ends up doing a lot of testing in the dev channel, spends there for a super long time, whereas there might be one feature that is in the dev channel for a little bit, then goes into a beta release. Because of this, the dev channel builds are named a little bit differently than the beta release channel or even public release built. And Microsoft actually has a webpage where you can see literally all of the Windows Insider builds that have been released for all the different versions of Windows. It's called the Flight Hub, and flighting is the term they use for running a early build of Windows. And you can see here that the dev channel builds just kind of have a general number that doesn't have like a major or minor build number with a decimal point or anything, whereas the beta and release channel actually do have the major version of Windows, which is like the biannual version, and then the decimal version, which is like the minor version of that major build. But the dev channel just kind of has random numbers in there. Well, not exactly random, but you know what I mean. The dev channel build number doesn't necessarily have anything to do with where it's going to end up in the public release. And by the way, I will do a better explanation of the build numbers and stuff in a little bit. And on this same page, you can actually see that the dev channel is going to get the most frequent updates. It looks like generally about once a week, but sometimes more. So now let's talk about the beta channel. And there are several major differences between the beta channel and the dev channel. So first one being that the beta channel does have builds that are actually tied to a final public release. So while the dev channel may have features added into it that are more or less experimental with no necessarily timeline on when it will be released, with a beta build though, any features that are in there pretty much means that those features are gonna almost certainly end up in the next final public release. Now another difference is that the beta channel is way more stable than the dev channel. In fact, on the info page about the different channels, Microsoft even specifically calls the beta channel reliable. And also it says that beta channel updates have been validated, which means that basically it's gone through some bug filtering, a certain level of testing to verify its stability. So you're not going to probably have any major issues like you could potentially have with the dev channel. If you are someone who likes to be an early adopter, you may very well choose to use the beta channel on a personal computer, but I probably still wouldn't do it on anything mission critical, like where you're literally using it to make money for work and stuff like that, because obviously it is way more stable than dev channel, but that doesn't mean there's not gonna be any bugs. I mean, that's the whole point of a beta channel, is to find the bugs before it goes out to everybody publicly. So just kind of be aware of that. I believe another common use for the beta channel is for IT professionals who maybe work for a company, they handle migrating and updating all the computers for a company. They may install the beta channel on test computers to make sure that all the company software works with upcoming versions of Windows. And if there's any issues, then they can make sure that it all works before the final version comes along. Another advantage is if you do use the beta channel and you do come across bugs or issues, you can give feedback that will be probably more closely looked at. For example, with the feedback hub, that's Microsoft's thing where you can submit bug reports and feedback and stuff and suggestions. They're probably going to be looking more closely at beta users because there's fewer of them, it's easier to manage them, and you know, they want to make sure that they get all these bugs before it goes out in a release. Now, as for the update frequency, based on the beta channel update history for Windows 10, it kind of seems like new builds are no more than once a week, but occasionally there are several weeks between them. So again, generally less frequent than the dev channel, of course, but it does look like the updates become a little bit more frequent the closer to the public release. Now, hold on for a second before we get to the release preview channel, because apparently there are also some special internal channels that are not available to the public and are used for internal testing by Microsoft employees. There's barely any details on these internal channels. I literally just read about them on Wikipedia, so a lot of this is gonna be just purely my speculation, but I thought it'd be interesting to mention them. One of these is the Canary channel, which apparently is the very first stop. Anytime any brand new code gets written, it goes into the Canary channel. It apparently has very little testing, probably extremely unstable and buggy, and pretty much gets updated daily. Then up next is the self-host channel. So after a little bit of testing is done, I guess in Canary, it's in the self-host channel, which is used to do some testing before it's even sent to the dev channel. So this is probably just to make sure that there's no devastating bugs or anything like that. Then the third internal channel is the Microsoft channel, which is actually, I think, the most interesting. It's actually between the dev channel and beta channel. With this, apparently the build gets rolled out company-wide, I guess to do as much testing as possible to make sure that all the big bugs and maybe even most bugs are sorted out before even getting to the beta build. Because remember, the beta build is supposedly supposed to be reliable, so you would hope so. So it kind of makes sense that they would roll it out to as many people as possible internally without actually going public. I also assume this is the stage where they decide which features to put into which builds and schedule them for eventual public release. And apparently those are the only three internal channels that are known, at least according to Wikipedia. So we can now talk about the final release channel, which is the preview release channel. And and this one is the last stop before an update gets released as a public release. And what I assume is that any build in the release preview channel theoretically should be ready for release, and that hopefully all bugs have been found. But obviously with anything, the more people that use a piece of software or a certain build, the more likely it is to find the rare edge cases and rare bugs. So it's just kind of like one final step to make sure you catch anything that you might have missed, hopefully. And I also believe that the release preview channel should be at least almost as stable as a final release. Another important thing I want to note is that the release preview channel will also get early minor updates that are released for a major update after the major update is released. So at this point, let me explain what the whole thing between major builds and minor builds are. And you might have even wondered this, even if you just use Windows generally and you look at the version of Windows or build you're running, you can now understand what these numbers all mean. So the major build of a Windows version is just the number to the left of the decimal place. So these are the big feature updates, the ones that are semi-annual for Windows 10 and are going to be annually for Windows 11. And these are also known as the release versions. So you may also see it called 21H1, first half of 21, 20H2, that sort of thing. So for example, all Windows 10 21H1 builds start with 19043, and 20H2 was 19042, 20H1 was 19041, and so on. Now the minor build number is determined by the number to the right of the decimal place. So these minor builds are basically just little incremental updates to the big major build. And one important thing to note is that these minor build versions and minor updates are not just for early test versions of a big release and then that's it once it's released. These minor builds are also going to be the patches that are applied to a major build after the major build initial final version is released. And these are usually in the form of the monthly patches that Microsoft releases, usually the second Tuesday of the month called Patch Tuesday. When Patch Tuesday goes out, then you probably will notice that the minor build version of your Windows version will go up. And these minor builds are not gonna have any new features or anything though, generally. It's just gonna have bug fixes, security updates, that sort of thing. Now also remember that I mentioned that the release preview channel, in addition to getting the early final build of a major release, it will also get slightly early versions of each minor release after that. So we can see that on this page that lists all the different preview builds. For example, with Windows 10 21H1, it says that the final build that was pushed to public was 19043.928. Now we can actually see that there were more than one release preview channel builds before the final one. So I guess they released the release preview and then did fix some stuff before the final one. But more importantly, notice how after 928, the release preview channel kept getting roughly monthly updates. And these were generally in the second half of the month after the most recent Patch Tuesday happened, but before the next one. So you basically get the next Patch Tuesday early. So anyway, the main thing I want to point out here is that for both the beta and release preview channels, you're going to not just get a little bit early versions of the major releases, but also early versions of the minor releases every month. You can see that these were like in the second half of every month. So that was going to be for the next following Patch Tuesday. So again, for the release preview channel, they wait until the next major version is just about ready before you get those. And in the meantime, you just get the minor updates early. So now that you know how the major and minor build versions work, one reason I wanted to bring all that up is because, like I mentioned at the beginning of the video, there is actually a secret way that you can get early versions of the minor builds without even being a member of an insider program. So like I said, the minor updates are generally going to be monthly and the second Tuesday of the month, Patch Tuesday. And these are also the mandatory updates. So eventually they're going to be auto-installed by anyone with Windows. And again, while the beta and release preview channels get these minor updates about a month early, there is actually a special window of time between when those channels do get the early update downloaded and the actual Patch Tuesday, usually around the end of the month. If you actually go and check manually for updates in Windows, you will generally be offered an optional update for the early patch. So depending on when you watch this video, if you go and do that and you see something called an optional quality update or a cumulative update preview, that's exactly what this is. You don't have to, of course, it's not going to auto install or anything, but you can choose to install it. And you can see at the time I recorded this video, there was one available. So this is just kind of a cool way you can get minor updates a little bit early between the preview channels and the public release. Though I will point out that these minor updates almost never have any new features or anything. There was one exception where Microsoft released that news and interests widget in a minor update, but that's a very rare exception. However, this might be good to know if you are experiencing weird issues with Windows, maybe you're coming across a bug and you want to check manually if there's an optional update, because maybe that next patch will have a fix for the bug you're experiencing. So it might just be something to try. So anyway, going back to the Windows Insider program, should you join it and which channels should you join if you do want to? Well, the point of the video is hopefully you can just decide for yourself at this point with all this knowledge, though I would personally recommend just doing either the release preview channel or the beta channel, if any. It seems like the release preview channel updates are stable enough where it's basically just like getting the normal updates early. And then the beta channel is just even more early, though maybe not as polished as the release preview. Again, with the dev channel, I would definitely recommend against that unless you really know what you're doing. And the reason, again, is because you generally can't really leave the dev channel without doing a clean install. With the beta and release preview channels, on the other hand, what you can do is if you go into the Windows Insider settings in Windows, you can choose stop getting preview builds. And what this will do is you will continue to get the preview update builds until the next major release. And that's just because you're also going to be getting the security updates in each one. However, once the next major build is released, then you'll be all synced up and then you'll stop getting the preview builds. So no matter what Insider channel you're in, you can't go backwards in build numbers without doing a clean install. So definitely keep that in mind. It's all about a risk trade-off where if you do happen to come across some weird bug in the beta version, for example, and it completely breaks your computer and you want to stop using the beta builds altogether, then you would theoretically have to wait until the next major version, which with Windows 11 is only going to be once a year. So either you hope that the next beta build will have a fix, or just do a clean install and then not have to wait for the next major one. But the idea is that the beta build should at least be pretty polished, where those are not going to be a real concern, but you might come across rare edge cases in the beta build, and then probably even less so in the release preview build. And another advantage of the release preview build is even if you do decide, I want to stop getting these, then they're only released a short time before the final one, so if you do want to leave the Insider program, you don't have to wait very long for that. So that's just all stuff to kind of be aware of and do the calculation for yourself. So with all this knowledge, you might be wondering, how do you actually go and join the Insider program? Well, it's actually not really hard at all. So what you do is go to the Insider Microsoft webpage. That's just insider.windows.com. And then you click the register button, and it's going to have you log into your Microsoft account and then agree to some things. And once you do that on the webpage, you can go back into the Windows settings. And there you go to update and security settings, and then look for Windows Insider program. And then you basically just click get started or whatever and follow all the prompts, and it will have you link a Microsoft account. Now, if you're using a local Windows account to log into your computer, that's fine. This is not going to link or require you to log in to your computer with a Microsoft account. It's literally just going to link the Microsoft account to the Windows Insider thing. So after you do that, it'll ask you which channel you want to join and tell you a little bit about all the stuff we just talked about. I believe you then have to do a restart before you actually get the Insider updates, but once you do, when you go to check for updates, it should start downloading the latest Insider build for your particular channel. So really, I think that's pretty much all you have to know about Insider builds and Windows updates in general. Also, thanks again to Mine for sponsoring this video. Be sure to go to saymine.com so you can also start reclaiming your data. And of course, you can click the same link down in the description. If you guys enjoyed this video and found it useful, definitely give it a thumbs up. Let me know what you think down in the comments. And also, if you want to subscribe, be sure to click the bell to get notifications, because I only upload about twice a week. You don't want those to get lost in the rest of your subscriptions. If you guys want to keep watching, the next video I'd highly recommend is where I was talking about those app data folders in Windows. And you may have wondered what exactly those are for. I go into very much detail, and I think you'll be very interested in some of the stuff you learn there. So definitely check that out. I'll put the link right there. And thanks so much for watching. I'll see you in the next one.